Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this wonderful venue and to the 15th World Congress on Public Health. I'm Helen Kelleher and I'm Congress Convener, and I can't tell you how exciting it is to be here after so much planning, so welcome. First, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which we meet today, and we look forward to Auntie Joy Murphy's formal welcome to country shortly. But I've just got a few things first that I want to put onto your thinking. But I would also like to acknowledge that this year, this event has been many years in what we've called the curating, really. It started with an email in 2012 from the Melbourne Convention Bureau, thank you, Bev, who said, there's this event, you know, you're the president of the Public Health Association, perhaps you'd like to think about putting in a submission. And I'd been wanting the Public Health Association of Australia to look beyond our borders, to be more involved in the global public health scene, because as you know, disease and poverty and poor health know no borders, and we do need to work together as a global community. So it didn't take a lot of persuading for me for the Public Health Association to agree to put in the bid, and really the rest is history. We won. The year of the Congress was brought forward by a year, just to add a little bit of pressure. But that also means that we're celebrating, of course, the 50th birthday of the World Federation of Public Health Associations, which is a fantastic milestone you'll hear more about during this Congress. The set design, folks, is what we're about, transforming our world through the sustainable development goals that we all work towards. They're about ending poverty, protecting the planet, reducing inequalities, increasing gender equity, and so on. You should all be able to recite them in your sleep by the end of this Congress. Through the next few days, we'll be honoured by the attendance of many dignitaries, and today I'd like to acknowledge that we're joined by senior World Health Organisation representatives from our various offices, particularly Geneva, and we're so grateful that you're here with us today. Public Health Association leaders from around the world, World Federation Office, obviously, staff and leaders. But particularly today, we're honoured by the presence of the Federal Minister for Health, the Honourable Greg Hunt, also the Minister for Sport, and for Victoria, the Honourable Martin Foley, who's the MP for this seat of Albert Park, and has a huge portfolio, I don't know when you sleep, Martin, mental health, housing, disability, ageing, equity, and creative industries. So we look forward to hearing from you both shortly. So on behalf of the National Organising Committee, a wonderful group of people who've worked so hard for the last 3 years, we welcome all of you, all our official guests, our speakers, sponsors, exhibitors, and delegates to this Congress. You are most welcome, and I look forward to meeting as many of you as possible over the next few days. The biggest challenge you will have until Friday is actually deciding what to go to, because we have 17 keynote speakers, 23 world leadership dialogues or symposium, 36 panels, 28 workshops, 124 oral sessions, 4 storytelling sessions, and hundreds of posters. It's going to be absolutely amazing. We will be doing some content capture, which means that we will be videoing all the main plenary sessions and the world leadership dialogues that are held in these halls. We will need some funding to do some editing on them, post-production work, to make sure they're suitable to go onto the websites of our partner organisations. But it does mean that we can share what we've heard with all your colleagues around the world. We've got a very strong equity theme running through this whole Congress, and we know that not everybody who would like to come can come. So we want to share those learnings using digital platforms that are now available to us. In your satchel, you'll find this gorgeous little program booklet, which is an easy-to-use guide for your sessions. But all the abstracts are on the app, another digital platform that we're able to use now. It's free on the App Store. If you haven't already downloaded it, please do so. And this is where you'll get alerts and updates. Now, I know that the public health community is often on steroids on social media, so you Twitter away, everybody. Here are our handles and hashtags. We want you to use them at Public Health Association Congresses and Population Health Congresses with our partners in the past. We've trended and we hope to trend every day this week. If you need assistance with anything, we've got 100 enthusiastic student volunteers studying public health or medicine. They're wearing blue t-shirts and they'll be here throughout the Congress. Plus, we have the wonderful team from ICMSA, our conference organisers, who are available around the building, but particularly at the registration desk. All our media is being managed by Science in Public, a great team of science journalists who are working to ensure that your research and our messages reach far and wide, and already that's happening. You may have noticed the birdcage downstairs on the exhibition level. Well, it's actually upstairs from here, where a lot of media interviews will take place. It's looking fantastic. Just the boring housekeeping things. Please keep your personal belongings with you at all times. This is a public space and we don't want anything going missing. If there is an emergency, please follow the instructions of the Melbourne Convention Centre staff who you can see around the building at all times. The posters, I just want to mention, are all digital. We're trying to save trees by not having posters carried around by people. They'll be on level one at the poster stations where there are big monitors set up, and you'll be able to see the schedule for those during the lunchtime breaks on the app. There will also be constant screenings of videos of the World Federation of Public Health Association history, its achievements, past presidents and so on. They'll be on loops on those monitors throughout. We're not having a conference dinner, folks. We're having a party. We're having a party down on South Wharf in marvellous Melbourne, which is just around behind the Melbourne Convention Centre, at 6:30 tomorrow night. It's going to be fantastic. We're on the river with the lights of the city behind us. There'll be pop-up entertainment and brilliant food and drinks, of course, of all types. It doesn't require a ticket. It was included in your registration. If you no longer wish to attend, please just hand your ticket back at the registration desk so we can confirm numbers. So we had many wonderful Congress partners who've been working, as I said, to bring this Congress to life. And these are partner organisations who've worked together before in Australia to bring population health congresses to fruition. The Public Health Association of Australia, the Public Health Association of New Zealand, the Australasian Faculty of Public Health Medicine, the Australian Epidemiological Association, the Australian Health Promotion Association, and the Australian Women's Health Network. And I'd also like to thank our many sponsors for their support, because without that, this Congress would not be possible. So a big thank you to the Australian Government Department of Health, the Melbourne Convention Bureau, and the Victorian Department of Health and Human Services, the Victorian Health Promotion Foundation, Parks Victoria, Victorian Department of Environment, Land and Water Planning, Business Events Australia, the City of Melbourne, Deakin University, the Royal Life Saving Society of Australia, and Oxford University Press. I hope I haven't missed anybody. The Black Dog Institute, I did miss. Sorry about that. A late comer onto our scene, but very much appreciated for one of the World Leadership Dialogues. So please ensure that you take the time during the breaks to meet new colleagues, visit the exhibitions, and make the most of your time with us. It's going to be a truly wonderful event. And it's now my pleasure to introduce the chair for this session, Michael Moore, who is the CEO of the Public Health Association of Australia and president of the World Federation of Public Health Associations. He's a former Minister for Health and Community Care as an independent member of the Australian Capital Territory from 1989 to 2001. There's many things we can say about him. He writes a political and social column weekly. He serves as chair of a number of health networks and boards. He's an adjunct associate professor with the University of Canberra, where he is a PhD scholar examining health advocacy. Please make him welcome.
Professor Helen Kelleher, what a dynamo. What you are probably not aware of is that this Congress would not have happened without Helen's initiative, without her drive, without her commitment to the thing, and I'd like to hear a really great sound of applause. So on behalf of the World Federation of Public Health Associations, it's my pleasure to welcome you to this 15th World Congress on Public Health. The World Federation, members and friends, this is a time to raise our voices, to incorporate past achievements into a vision for the future, and to plan action. And I will come back to that. But first, it's going to be my great pleasure to welcome Auntie Joy Murphy to welcome us to her land and her country. Auntie Joy Murphy is a member of the Order of Australia. That is not given lightly, as that great honour is to do with her work in social justice. And so having somebody who has worked so much in social justice is a great pleasure, and how appropriate for the start of this World Congress. Auntie Joy Murphy of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation.
Thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here. And I'd like to begin by paying my respects to the Wurundjeri people, the traditional custodians of this land. I'd like to also acknowledge my late father. He served in World War I and, of course, was rejected, not being recognised as a legal citizen of this country. However, we're all very aware of what happened in World War I and the depletion of our soldiers. So he, like so many others, ended up serving. On his return, he was told to go and find somewhere else to live, not stay with his mum or his brothers or his sisters. And when we're talking about the health of one people, and particularly our people on Wurundjeri country, it's really hard for me to believe that today has seen so many changes, and yet those who serve for this country, those who put their lives on the line, couldn't have that recognition. However, it is my pleasure to be here, because with change and with the help and support of so many people through the years, and my work is done like everybody else's. If we work together, then hopefully we will achieve and we will make change for the better. I do want to thank very much Helen for the invitation to be with you again. And it is a moment in time that I don't forget, and I take it very seriously, because the health of our people, hopefully one day we'll be able to say there's so many lists of things that are occurring still in our community today. But not only what happens to our people, not only the death rate, not only the imprisonment rate, all of those other issues that happen elsewhere, it's the way in which those issues come about. It takes me back to the time when our people were paid by grog, by alcohol for their services, paid by giving them tobacco, and we wonder why they have so many serious illnesses today. When doctors and nurses are only able to fly in at a certain time and are only there for a short time, and then they change. And then there's the language barriers. There's so many issues that we need to overcome. We represent less than 2.5% of this total population. It cannot be that hard. So I say to you that we don't look at what the health issues are. We need to undress those. We need to look at what is causing those health issues. And for me, I just think that I'm so fortunate to have a platform where so many people in our community don't have that. Could I also thank the organising committee, and also I'm very proud of our younger ones that are coming through and being able to be a part of such an important progress in this Congress. And could I also acknowledge each and every one of the brothers and sisters from the many countries that are here today, and pay my respects to your ancestors, to your elders and your communities. Also like to acknowledge our very, very favourable, the Honourable Martin Foley. And Martin, you have that many portfolios, it's not even funny. But you do a great job and we do thank you very much. And the Honourable Greg Hunt, thank you for another wonderful way in which is expressed at a federal level that the care for Aboriginal people, I hope, must continue and will continue in the right vein. I do come from the oldest living culture in the world. I'm a very proud mother of 7 children, 11 grandchildren and 5 great-grandchildren. And like my mum and dad, it's been a family that's kept me ungrounded. It's kept me on my feet. It's kept me saying that what I can do, I will do. And however I do it, it will only be for the best. When my dad was passing at the age of not quite 14, I was, and I said to him, please leave me with something. Not sure what I was asking for. I was in shock, I think. And but he said to me, you are who you are. Be proud of who you are. But you are no better than you are no better than anyone else. And I'd like to think that I've considered each and every person that to be equal to one another. And I thank my father for those wonderful words. We are known as the Manigum people, and I picked these beautiful leaves this morning. And looking across the mountains of where our people have lived for thousands and thousands of years, looking at the beautiful mist on the mountains, a really low fog, and then above that fog was these amazing air balloons. And I said, well, there is a future, and a future that where we can all walk together. And this is the symbolism of these leaves. It's about sharing with you what we've all been given. And these come from the gift. They are the gift of the land. I'll take this leaf on your behalf, and I hope that you accept it. Accepting this leaf means that you are welcome to everything, from the tops of the trees to the roots of the earth. And it also means you join with me to pay your respects and honour the spirits of our ancestors who have nurtured this land for many, many thousands of years. It is indeed an honour and a privilege to be with you each and all, and thank you for all that you do for all the many people across this world. My language is the Woi Wurrung, Wurundjeri Wurundjeri Balak, Yemen, Kundibik, and you are most welcome to the traditional lands of the Wurundjeri people. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Auntie Joy. What a moving welcome to country. I think it was absolutely brilliant. And so acknowledging myself, your traditional owners, your elders, past and present, those are the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. And I'd also like to acknowledge 2 particular Indigenous people here today. So in my own association, our Vice President for Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, Summer Mae Finlay, and from the World Federation of Public Health Associations, Maori man, Adrian Tapatu. I'd like to particularly acknowledge you, along with all other Indigenous people who are here with us today. And while we're thinking of other people, I think it's also appropriate for us to acknowledge the pain and the public health issue that's being felt in Queensland following Cyclone Debbie, in Colombia, where a major landslide has killed over 100 people. And sometimes in public health, we need to make sure we do understand those things that are going on. But 50 years ago today, a group of public health associations from across the world joined together with the intention of being more effective. What they wanted to do was make a difference. We are gathered here today to do just that, to make a difference. We can have a healthier society. Our public health predecessors have shown us the way. Our roads are safer. Our children are protected from many infectious diseases by vaccination. We have clean water, we have sanitation across large parts of the world. In parts of Australia, our smoking rates are below 10%. Women have much more control over their own fertility. Childbirth is safer. And this hasn't happened by accident. There have been many public health heroes. I would like to mention just one. The one I would like to mention is the late Basil Hetzel. Basil passed away earlier this year, and his contribution to understanding the impact of iodine deficiency was extraordinary. But he did more. He then drove the change in policy to ensure that we had iodized salt, that we had a method of dealing with it. Our predecessors have made a difference in so many ways. Unfortunately, it has not been for everyone to share in those successes. So the challenge for the next 50 years is to ensure that the advantages continue. They are not undermined, but that everyone shares in those better health outcomes. This means first understanding the social, cultural, economic and environmental determinants of health, understanding the emerging issues and their causes, and the causes of the causes, as Sir Michael Marmot would say. And these include non-communicable diseases, includes antibiotic resistance, it includes the effects of climate change, and so much more. But it also means working together to develop clear plans for improving health over the next 50 years, and it means delivering such plans through effective advocacy. It is no accident that the theme of this conference is Voices, Vision, Action. These are the fundamentals for making a difference. This is why we are gathered in Melbourne at this World Congress on Public Health to make a difference. Public health professionals around the globe are here, working together to get a joint direction. It's an effort that is needed to improve the public's health for the future. And it is particularly important in the context of a globalised world. Voices have been heard. Public health associations internationally, many of our international civil society colleagues and friends have not only joined us in developing this Congress, they have participated in the development of the Global Charter for the Public's Health. That charter sets out a clear vision for improving health globally. And now it's up to the World Federation, each of its members, other NGOs, governments, and you as individuals to develop action in order to implement this important vision. Voices, vision, action. During this Congress, we will also celebrate the 50th anniversary of the World Federation of Public Health Associations, and we'll do that on the Congress party on Tuesday evening and on World Health Day on Friday. The celebration marks 50 years of public health advocacy coordinated across associations around the world. And during this time, we have learnt lessons, we've gained expertise, we've become established thought leaders for addressing public health needs at local, national and international levels. And we are here to build on that knowledge and that understanding. We're here to take the baton from our predecessors and to head into the future, taking public health leadership for the next 50 years. And when I look around me, when I looked around me last night, when I look around me now, I see so many young people here. And you, the young people, I challenge you, in particular, I challenge you, the young people at this Congress, to take on the leadership of the future. It's time for you to knock me and my colleagues off our pedestals. It's time for you to remove the grey beards and take over from them, and those who can't grow grey beards as well but are of the same era. Take over from us. Grasp the nettle. Get out there. Challenge governments. Engage with them. Challenge unhealthy industries. You have the knowledge. You have the voice. You have the vision. Now it is time to take action. This is why we have developed the Global Charter, so that you, can tap in to our experience. This is why we have developed the Melbourne Demand for Action. The World Federation, along with all our Congress partners, have developed a Melbourne Demand for Action, which will be considered on Thursday. And you'll have the opportunity to support it. My World Federation President-elect, my successor, Professor Letitia Respel from South Africa, will present the Melbourne Declaration to the meeting on Thursday to give individual attendees the opportunity to offer their support, which will be done by acclamation. We will ensure that that will be put on the app in the next couple of days. What we want to do is provide a model for working together. And that's what you're charged with doing, not just the young people, but all of us. The Global Congress is an opportunity for public health leaders and professionals from around the world to join together to make health a priority issue, to make a difference. It's an opportunity to use our voices to promote public health. It's an opportunity for the vision that to build on the visions, such as the Declaration of Alma Ata, such as the Ottawa Charter. It's an opportunity to consider current visions, such as the Sustainable Development Goals, such as the Global Charter for the Public Health. And it's an opportunity to take action in the knowledge, the tools, and the skills that have been developed as public health professionals to work with government, to work with industry, to work with academia, to work with civil society, to protect the public's health. This Friday is World Health Day. We celebrate on that, we also celebrate 50 years of the World Federation. It's time for us to appreciate and recognise the present, to learn from the achievements, the mistakes, the actions, and the inaction of the past. We have come a long way, but in one sense, it's just the beginning. It's my hope that this event inspires you to continue in the pursuit of better health, not just better health for ourselves, but for better health for everyone on this planet. It's now my pleasure to welcome Professor Patina Borish to address the Congress. Professor Borish is a histopathologist, and a fellow of the Royal College of Pathology. She's an editor of the Journal of Public Health Policy and editor-in-chief of Pathobiology. She's also the executive director of the World Federation of Public Health Associations and teaches at the University of Geneva in Switzerland. Professor Borish.
Ladies and gentlemen, first of all, it's my honor to acknowledge the Burundi people on which land we are meeting today, and to honor also their elders, past and present, and all the other First Nations people that are here and in the world. Today, we are all gathered here because we want to work for a world where all people can live healthy and peaceful lives. And this Congress and all its sessions will be finally about that at the end of the day. And as the Executive Director of the World Federation, I'm already now looking forward to all what this Congress has to bring to public health in the coming week, following week. And let me say, I'm already now proud of you, of all of you. But today, and more than ever today, I would like just to remind us all of a basic value that is the foundation of all our work. Solidarity. In times like this, where some political powers are at rise, it's easy to be skeptical about solidarity. The concept of solidarity is based on the idea that people can unite across their differences, not just because they are good people, but because they have a common interest, allowing themselves not to be divided and conquered. We are usually taught that the only way to go ahead in this society is to outcompete your neighbors. But while this may be true for businesses, it has never been true for ordinary people. For example, the biggest gains for workers have not come through individuals trying to defeat and to establish superiority over others to go ahead, but by uniting into unions to raise everyone's standard of life and health. This isn't just true for workers in unions, but it's true among ordinary people across different gender, different nations, different tribes, different countries, different life situations, and among people who suffer oppression and are divided against each other. It follows from this that solidarity isn't just an abstract concept, but a true and real network of trust and reliability. I just want to make it clear, I'm talking here about solidarity, not about charity or about the sometimes empty rhetoric of love and unity that we may hear or read about sometimes. The skepticism about solidarity is sometimes expressed by dismissing people who want to give support to oppressed people by saying, okay, you just do it because you want yourself to feel good. But this distinction dismisses the whole point. Creating and building solidarity does feel good because we do have mutual interest, all of us. Let me take two classical examples of oppression or divide that we're still struggling with. Racism and the status of women. Both are deleterious for individual persons' health and for health on the whole planet. There are two common ideas about racism and other forms of oppression. The first is that these are old, gradually disappearing ideas. The second is that they are an unchanging element of human being and that they will be always with us. Both views are wrong. Oppressions are a product of a deeply unequal society where a minority maintains its grip on a majority to keep it divided so it won't unite against them. In this sense, women are a symbolic minority, if we understand the meaning of minority as a group of people who, because of their physical or cultural differences, characteristics, are singled out from the society where they are living just for differential and unequal treatment. But oppressions can be fought by movements of solidarity. Whether they are challenged and eventually overcome depends on the struggle against them. Examples show women have gained civil rights, as have people of color. I may say, coming from Switzerland, even in the canton of Appenzell in Switzerland, women have the right to vote now. It's only since 20 years, but yes, they do. So it happens. The best, and let's come to a very important point that is scientifically well documented and shown. The best predictor of a state's stability, peacefulness, and health is how its women and minorities are treated. Populist movements gained support by proposing a sham vision of solidarity. Solidarity just with some people, not with all. Do not let political movements split people into those and the others. I call upon you to meet the others. Solidarity is a lifelong learning process, and it should be a transgenerational knowledge. Be aware, when you go back home, look at the small signs of desolidarity and go against them. Do not forget, fascist movements, all of them, built their base not on the politically active, but on the politically non-active. So in this sense, let us make this World Congress a success. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Borish. It's now my great pleasure to introduce a video address from the President of the Republic of Uruguay. The President of the Republic had hoped to be with us up until about 3 weeks ago, and apparently presidents have other things that happen. So he was kind enough to send us a video. So if we can now have the video, please, of the President of the Republic of Uruguay, President Vasquez.
Señoras y señores, integrantes del Comité Organizador del 15º Congreso de Salud Pública 2017, estimada profesora Helen Killeher, profesora Heather Zittman, señor Michael Moore, colegas de todo el mundo presentes en este Congreso, realmente me siento orgulloso de poder comunicarme con todos ustedes por este medio. Tareas y compromisos inherentes al ejercicio del cargo que me ha conferido la ciudadanía uruguaya han hecho imposible que esté presente en este momento con ustedes, como era sin duda alguna mi deseo. Y como ustedes saben, el cáncer se puede evitar, se puede prevenir, y el único camino es la educación y la información a la población. Debemos darles las herramientas a la población para luchar contra esta enfermedad. En el día de hoy, deseo hablarles sobre un agente causante de muchos cánceres que se padecen en la humanidad. Hablo del tabaco y del tabaquismo. Esta sustancia que mata año a año a más personas que lo que mataron las dos guerras mundiales juntas no puede ser tomada a la ligera, no lo puede ser. Los gobiernos debemos tomar medidas efectivas para luchar contra este flagelo. Estamos ante una epidemia de cáncer industrialmente producida. El tabaquismo no solo produce daño sanitario, sino que también produce un severo daño económico a los estados, porque los costos directos e indirectos causados por el tabaco suelen por lo menos duplicar o triplicar lo recaudado por impuestos al tabaco, como sucede precisamente en mi país. Para que ustedes tengan una idea del poder económico de la industria tabacalera, que se ha transformado en capacidad de influencia política y manipulación, les comento que cuando se inició la discusión del convenio marco en el año 2004, el ingreso anual de la principal multinacional tabacalera del mundo, la empresa Philip Morris, más que duplicaba el Producto Bruto Interno de Uruguay y superaba el de algunos países de América Latina, todos juntos. Durante muchas décadas, estas empresas abusaron de su poder económico y capacidad de lobby, impidiendo la aplicación de regulaciones para proteger la vida y la salud de nuestros ciudadanos. Por tanto, estos productos deben ser regulados de acuerdo a la severidad del daño que provocan. Por esa razón, y llegando al gobierno en el año 2005 aquí en Uruguay, decidimos llevar adelante el convenio marco para el control de tabaco de la Organización Mundial de la Salud. En ese sentido, implementamos las siguientes medidas. Durante el periodo de gobierno 2005-2010, aumentamos significativamente el precio y los impuestos a todos los productos de tabaco, homologando el tabaco de armar a los cigarrillos. Aplicamos una política de ambientes cerrados con el objetivo de convertirnos en un país 100% libre de humo de tabaco. Se aplicó sin excepciones y logramos ser el primer país de las Américas en hacerlo. Implementamos advertencias sanitarias con imágenes muy duras de los efectos que produce el tabaco. Eso en los paquetes de cigarrillos, siendo nuestro país el primer país del mundo en aplicar esta medida aconsejada por el convenio marco. Asimismo, prohibimos totalmente la publicidad, promoción, patrocinio y exhibición de productos de tabaco en los puntos de venta, sin ningún tipo de excepción. Se prohibieron los términos engañosos, llegando en el 2010 a prohibir las distintas presentaciones de una misma marca, prohibir la publicidad sobre cigarrillos light, ultralight, mentolados, etc. Prohibimos la comercialización del cigarrillo electrónico. Lanzamos varias campañas de concientización a la población en general y una de ellas orientada a la mujer, sobre todo a la embarazada y el daño que produce que la madre fume a su próximo hijo. En el próximo año estaremos implementando otras medidas aplicadas, por ejemplo, a que no se pueda fumar en el entorno público de centros de estudio o centros hospitalarios. Durante el actual gobierno, el actual periodo de gobierno, el 23 de julio de 2015 comenzó a sesionar la Comisión Interinstitucional para la implementación del protocolo para la eliminación del comercio ilícito de productos de tabaco y en julio de 2016 decidimos implementar el empaquetado plano a partir del 2017. Ahora bien, ¿qué resultados han dado estas políticas en el Uruguay? En primer lugar, se redujo el nivel de contaminación del aire en ambientes cerrados en un 90%, pasando Uruguay a colocarse en el segundo puesto en mejor calidad de aire en interiores. Esto lo dio un estudio de la Yale University de New Haven. En cuanto al impacto en la prevalencia, se redujo el consumo en adultos, que era de un 32% en el 2006, de un 32%, a un 23% 5 años después. En jóvenes escolarizados, la prevalencia pasó de ser de un 30% en 2004 a un 9% en 2014. Y en médicos, nuestros colegas, de 27% en 2001 a 9.8% en 2011. La prevalencia del consumo de tabaco en jóvenes entre 13 y 17 años también disminuyó considerablemente entre el 2005, el año en que iniciamos estas medidas, y el 2014, ubicándose por debajo de un 10%. Todavía tenemos mucho para hacer, pero de a poco vamos avanzando. En cuanto al impacto sanitario, la prohibición de fumar produjo una reducción del ingreso por infarto agudo de miocardio a nuestros hospitales del orden de un 22%. Concomitantemente, el Estado recaudó mucho más por concepto de impuestos al tabaco. En el año 2004 se recaudaban 84 millones de dólares por año y en el 2011 se recaudaron 318 millones de dólares. Uruguay ha estado ganando por lo menos 100 millones de dólares anuales por su política de impuesto al tabaco. Por lo tanto, el control del tabaco ha generado una situación ganar-ganar, tanto en lo sanitario, que por supuesto es lo fundamental, como en lo económico e incluso como imagen internacional, dado que Uruguay es reconocido mundialmente por sus políticas de control del tabaco. Bien, el éxito de este pequeño país, allá en el sur de nuestro mundo, molestó a la mayor multinacional tabacalera y en un intento de amedrentamiento a un pequeño país en desarrollo, Philip Morris interpuso un reclamo legal ante el Centro Internacional de Arreglos de Diferencias relativas a inversiones del Banco Mundial. Lo que le preocupaba a esta empresa no era Uruguay y su mercado, que es muy pequeño, sino lo que le preocupaba era el antecedente que este país dejaría a nivel internacional en la lucha contra el tabaco. Uruguay no violó ningún tratado, ni expropió ninguna marca, ni aplicó medidas irracionales, solo hizo uso de su derecho soberano a proteger la vida y la salud de sus habitantes. Así fue reconocido por el tribunal arbitral que laudó totalmente en favor de nuestro país. Amigas y amigos, por todo lo dicho y mientras la biología me lo permita, me comprometo a trabajar incansablemente para lograr una reducción sustancial de las muertes ocasionadas por las enfermedades crónicas no transmisibles y sobre todo por las muertes generadas por el consumo de tabaco. Estoy seguro que lo podremos hacer todos juntos y que la victoria nos acompañará en esta lucha. Muchas gracias a todos.
Professor Tabaro Vasquez, of course, is an oncologist and came to power with knowledge, understanding and evidence, and then did something. Our Federal Health Minister, Greg Hunt, has an honours degree in law from the University of Melbourne. He was a Fulbright scholar. He studied a master's degree in international relations at Yale University. He headed Australia's electoral mission to Cambodia in 1998. In 2001, he was first elected to the federal member of Flinders. He's been Minister for the Environment and has been a long-term Minister for Health, almost 3 months now. But he comes with knowledge, understanding. And just as President Vasquez was able to use his knowledge and understanding to make a difference, we've already seen Greg Hunt buying in on the issue of vaccination, tackling that issue very strongly, and we hope that this will extend. 3 months is a short time, but already he's underway, and it's with great pleasure that I introduce Federal Health Minister Greg Hunt.
Thanks very much to Michael. To Auntie Joy, it is our privilege and honour to have you speak on behalf of Australia. And it is my privilege and honour to have as my partner in the Health Ministry, Ken Wyatt. For those of you who don't know, Ken was the first Indigenous member of the House of Representatives of the Australian Parliament. He is now also the first and long overdue Indigenous Minister in Australia, and he has responsibility for Indigenous health. So we are thrilled to have him. And Auntie Joy, you speak for Indigenous Australia, and he speaks for Indigenous Australia within the ministry and as his passion for Indigenous health. I want to also, though, to say to Michael Moore, as the president of the of the World Federation of Public Health Associations. You are a force of nature along with Bettina as Executive Director, and we're privileged to have both of you. To Professor Helen Kelleher, the Congress convener who comes from my own area, we're all privileged to have somebody such as her. But above all else, and I also acknowledge the Victorian Minister Martin Foley, to the 2,700 delegates from 83 countries who have come to Melbourne, welcome. Welcome to the 50th anniversary of the World Federation of Public Health Associations. Welcome to the 15th World Public Health Congress. And welcome to the world's most livable city, Melbourne. I just wanted to say that because I was hoping there'd be somebody from Sydney in the audience. In fact, Melbourne has just been named the world's most livable city by the Economist Intelligence Unit for the sixth year in a row. One of the reasons, one of the fundamentals behind that, is access to good public health care. And as many of you would have seen, as you came in from Melbourne Airport and passed through the Parkville area, there is one of the world's great medical precincts. There's a fair argument that perhaps along with Boston and Cambridge, if you then combine Melbourne and Sydney together and think of them as a single medical research precinct, these could be among the world's great medical precincts. And that history is steeped in time. If you travel back to 1890, and if this Congress had been held in this city 127 years ago, the average life expectancy for women in the room would have been 50 years. For men, just over 47. Travel forward to today, to 2017, and the average life expectancy is 83 and more for women. For men, it's just over 80 years. It's a 33-year increase, and that is your doing and those who came before you. That is the work of the great public health advocates. That is the work of the people who have been involved in medical research and then the translation of that medical research to delivering the benefits to the people of the world. Real and systemic change that has transformed lives, has saved lives, and has improved lives. That is the tradition upon which this Congress is being founded. That is the tradition of which you are the current custodians. And in the same way that Auntie Joy talked about tradition and carriage and future, this Congress today, this week, is part of the broad, grand sweep of global history, charting back through Marie Pasteur and through Fleming, and then in Australia's own case, Florey and Macfarlane Burnet and Elizabeth Blackburn and Fiona Stanley and Fiona Wood, great public health advocates and researchers. You now stand in their shoes, and that is a wonderful thing. In this case, in this country, our health system is built on four great pillars. Firstly, universal access to medicines and to the great medical professionals, our doctors and our nurses. In this country, it's known as Medicare and the Pharmaceutical Benefits Scheme. And each year, our investment grows, as it should. And each year, the quality of healthcare improves, as it should, with new drugs for cystic fibrosis, such as Kalydeco, being made available to beautiful young children for the first time. New drugs for ovarian cancer being made available. These are the things which a good public health system should be able to provide for those who otherwise cannot afford it. But then we bring it forward to access to quality hospitals and to sustainable hospitals. And that's one of our great tasks that Martin and I and our colleagues between the federal and state governments are embarked upon in this country, making more places available for more people to improve their conditions. But our greatest success will be when fewer people are in need of those hospitals because they have been addressed earlier through genuine public and preventive health. And that's our third pillar. The third pillar of what we're doing in Australia is to focus on public and preventative health in the form of mental health, Indigenous health, and avoidable chronic disease. And we are embarked upon that process across the country. And our fourth pillar is the medical research, which will bring forward, along with many other countries and researchers from around the world, the next great wave of human history. And that is the precision medicine, which will allow us to decode the DNA, to sequence the genome, which is already occurring, but to make that available to individuals in each country and each place. So as where there is a scrambled DNA, where there is a code which is broken, we can unravel that and we can help repair it. And that will offer hope for people with motor neurone disease and cystic fibrosis and so many other conditions which until now had represented either a tragic sentence or a sentence of pain and loss of facility. And this threshold upon which we stand comes from the investment in medical research which is occurring across the world. So then we ask, well, what is it that we might be able to offer as an example, and an imperfect example, admittedly, but as one country's example of its preventive health initiatives? And really our own preventive health initiatives come across four great fronts. Firstly, as Michael mentioned, immunisation. Over the last 18 months, we've seen our no jab, no pay system see an increase of 200,000 young children who have now been immunised. Our immunisation rate in Australia is 93%. The immunisation rate for those who are subject to this system of benefits being deferred or withheld if the parents choose to put their children at risk, it's 94.5%. So a genuine public health success. But we can do better, and now we are seeking to embark upon the next great stage of that process. Secondly, there's the work that's been done on tobacco. We saw from the president of Uruguay a real example of public health success. In this country, over 4.5 decades, we have seen our smoking rates plummet. We are heading towards the goal of 10% by 2018. It is still too high in Indigenous Australia, and that will be our focus going forward. But through a variety of measures, a combination of price, of education, and of restrictive packaging elements over many decades and public health warnings, we have dramatically reduced that rate. Still, 15,000 people lose their battle with smoking-related cancers and diseases every year, so we must do more. But we are making progress, and that is one case of one country making success a reality in this case. Then, of course, there is alcohol and drugs. This is a global challenge. And we know that in our country, 200,000 people at least are currently using and suffering from the impact of ice. So one of the most profound of the methamphetamine family of drugs. And so right now, on this day, we are launching our new local drug action teams as part of a $300 million national initiative. And we'll be launching drug action teams to complement the law enforcement with the community engagement of working in our schools and our universities and our sporting clubs with young people. And then the last of the areas of public health in Australia is in relation to the question of what we do for healthy lifestyles. And with healthy lifestyles, what we are doing is investing in our schools to bring those disadvantaged children through the sporting schools program into the world of sports activity. Nothing unites kids more, nothing excites them more, and nothing brings them better lifelong health benefits than being engaged in sports activity. Add to that the guidance on eating. Add to that the work on diabetes, where only 2 days ago we made available in Australia for the first time access to continuous glucose monitoring for those type 1 diabetic children who otherwise would never have had access to it, which gives them the chance of a full life and gives their parents the chance of a night where they can, for the first time, sleep without fear of waking and sleep without nightmares that their child might not wake. So these are the things that we have done. We do that as a contribution because that's what a good society should do. We can all do more. We can all do better. That's one country's example of one way forward. This week, each of you are engaged in a great global task. When you trace back to Marie Pasteur and Fleming and, as I mentioned at the outset, Florey and McFarlane Burnett and Elizabeth Blackburn, you stand in the shoes of those who have come before and you make that path, lay the plans, set the vision, embark upon the task. I thank you, I honour you, I welcome you, and I am delighted to officially open the World Public Health Congress for 2017.
Thank you so much. The beginning of our challenge. I'd now like to invite the Minister from Victoria, Martin Foley, who has responsibility for social justice portfolios, housing, disability, mental health, equality. He has a background working in the public housing sector and community development in protecting the rights of vulnerable and working people. He has a master's degree from the University of Melbourne and a degree in history and politics from Monash, but applies that in such an important way in terms of public health. It's with great pleasure that I welcome Martin Foley.
Thank you very much for that warm introduction, Michael. And could I too begin by acknowledging that we meet here on the traditional country of the Wurundjeri and particularly pay my respects to elders past and present and acknowledge Aunty Joy Murphy for that warm welcome to country. And can I acknowledge elders and representatives of First Peoples from right across the globe. And whilst you're busy here in Melbourne, there's also a First Peoples cultural conference on at the moment, a festival on Yarramboy. So I'd recommend, in no doubt your heaps of spare time, that there's plenty to be got throughout Melbourne. Because of course, as the Federal Minister has indicated, Melbourne is the world's most livable city and we welcome you here to it. I'd also acknowledge, obviously, Minister Greg Hunt, the Federal Minister for Health, Professor Helen Keller as the Congress convener, and obviously you, Michael, as the World President of the Federation of Public Health Associations, and Professor Bettina Boyce for her contribution here. And on behalf of the Victorian Government, it's a great honour to welcome the 2,500 plus delegates from right around the world for this important Congress. Because of course, in the Australian Federated System, the delivery of so much of the work that you are here to discuss in this local context falls in partnership in large part to state governments. So we look with great interest as to how you will contribute to not just your global discussions, but how this is applied locally. Because this is a great opportunity to come together to build and to discuss not just how we can maintain and protect good health practices in local places, but indeed how we can build those public and population health systems, those systematic approaches to those many communities right around the world, including very close to where we sit here today, where far too many people are excluded from those systems, to make sure that we keep as well as make communities healthy. And here in Victoria, whilst we take great pride in our livability, as Greg had indicated, and the economic growth that we've had, unprecedented over a quarter of a century of continuous economic growth, we know that there is much more to be done in terms of how we share and distribute that economic growth, particularly around public health and population principles. And part of that goes to the fact that so much of our growth is built on welcoming peoples inclusively from all around the world. And this continues at a pace. By 2050, we'll be home to around 10 million people here. That's an increase of a further 4 million people in just over three decades. This, in raw numbers, is challenging enough. but there are other factors at play here when that population growth plays through. Whether it's in general advances in how our medical systems, as the Federal Minister has indicated, seek to build on the achievements to date, we know that not only will there be more people, but we will all be living longer. And whilst, of course, this is good news, increased longevity means all sorts of other challenges for us. And most fundamental of those is the increase in chronic disease, which will now see us having a responsibility rate of 85% of Australia's burden of disease will be from chronic diseases. And that will result in 9 in every 10 deaths of Australians at that time. In this context, to keep our increasing population healthy, we need to do a lot better with the many of the pillars that Greg indicated, particularly when it comes to prevention. And those are the challenges that you will be tackling this week. Like most comparable systems globally, we know that not everyone in our state enjoys the same health outcomes or indeed access to those outcomes. Many groups in our communities wear disproportionately the burden of disease, and their burden reflects wider social and economic disparities. We all know that the risks for chronic disease and preventable hospitalisations and poor health outcomes are correlated directly with poor education, unemployment, poverty, and social isolation. These social determinants of ill health are, we know, concentrated in areas associated with poor employment opportunities and lower access to social services. And through these, intergenerational transmission of disadvantage perpetuates this cycle. How to tackle inequalities and break the cycle of disadvantage for a healthier future is what we like to contemplate so much of our efforts around. Like you, we must focus on these social determinants whilst ensuring that the universal platforms of access to health services are of the highest calibre. And indeed, in how we deal with that will determine not just our local successes, but the sharings that you bring for your considerations here this week will help shape that. One of the key areas to ensure the massive growth that many of us are facing in health and public health and population health trends is, of course, prevention. That's why the Victorian Government is particularly focused on prevention and early intervention in much of its health investment. We know from our own and from international experience that what we have to do is approach this in a manner that delivers the greatest impact on those social determinants of health and well-being, and through this seek to directly address a reduction in inequality and the protection of our most vulnerable and at-risk communities so as to minimise the burden of disease. Put very simply, our focus isn't on how just we can treat 10 million people by the middle of the century. It's a question of how we can reduce disadvantage for those 10 million people. It's about how we can all work across government, across the community, and in partnership with our health professions and through the health population community so as to keep people who are vulnerable healthy and well. And today, amongst many, many examples that we can focus on, whether indeed, as I heard Helen on the radio this morning talk about sugar, or indeed whether it's the fact that the single largest killer of women under 45 in Australia is at the hands of a intimate partner or a former intimate partner, or indeed whether it would be our LGBTI communities, or indeed our Indigenous communities, there are so many applications of public health principles that I could spend the rest of your Congress, but that's what you're here for, to talk about. I just wanted to reflect ever so briefly on two. Like our federal member, I share a passion and a recognition that the impact that mental health and its relationship to many other expressions of ill health and hardship causes across our community. Here in Victoria, we've recently launched our 10-year mental health plan to try to implement a systematic approach to deal with the challenges of mental health and its wider implications across our society. Good mental health takes more than just good mental health services. This is a plan that seeks to address attitudes and behaviours, seeks to challenge stigma and discrimination, and has sought to prioritise in particular areas of suicide prevention as one particularly challenging area. A key to that outcome has been our investments towards suicide prevention through a coordinated whole of government and whole of community support that tries to make sure that our communities and our health services reduce our suicide toll. Our most recent figures show that over 654 Victorians lost their lives to suicide. That is more than the people who lose their lives on our road toll. In fact, it's more than double the numbers of people who die on our roads. And we have set ourselves a goal over this next 10-year period to reduce that by half. Our suicide prevention framework seeks to support health services and to test assertive outreach models to better support people and their families in vulnerable areas, particularly following suicide attempts. Because we know that through place-based programs, where local communities will develop and lead and implement those local programs, that is essentially the application of the principles that your association has tried and tested over so many years. And I was particularly pleased to see that the federal-backed public health networks have now aligned with the work of the Victorian Community Mental Health Services to make sure that we lever off even more investment to extend that system to 12 areas across our state. And I welcome my colleague, the Federal Minister's priority of making sure mental health and suicide prevention are a priority for him and his government. And I look forward to how we can further ensure that the principles and practices of bringing down suicide rates, and particularly youth suicide rates, can be jointly achieved. This is vital work in its own right, but it is also important in that it aligns with the World Health Organization's focus when it says, and I quote, "There is no health without mental health," and I welcome the World Health Organization's theme for World Health Day this Friday, depression, let's talk about it. I just wanted to also briefly reflect on, again, a global movement that we've seen play out in our own local community. We know that globally, the irregular movements of people is taking place at an unprecedented level, on a scale never seen before. It is confronting political and moral issue for all nations, particularly those nations that arguably have had a role in those factors that have pushed many people into this mass movement. And even doubly so for those states such as ours, where many people seek to make good their futures. These mass movements of people also raise community and population health challenges on a scale that is commensurate with that unprecedented level of population movement. That's why the Victorian Government is proud of our support for newly arrived Victorians and those seeking refuge here. We do so at a time in across the globe when we see walls of many types going up globally, when we know that cooperation between people across borders is more important than ever to deal with those mental health and physical challenges of so many of those newly arrived communities and communities who are shifting across the globe at record numbers. And we know that such cooperation approaches not only are more successful in dealing better outcomes for those people, but in dealing with some of the geopolitical as well as the health issues. This is where conferences like this, opportunities to display the best of humanity, where the international community and health professionals can point to the evidence and convince nations, especially wealthy and well-positioned nations such as our own, to show the necessary compassion and leadership to build better health and community outcomes for such globally displaced people, who in such relatively minor numbers, us as a nation here, go to such extraordinary lengths and at times to shun. Here in Victoria, as a sub-national government, we know that there is more we can do. We have increased significantly funding each year to provide targeted health and human services and support for refugees and those seeking asylum. We have expanded programs that include refugee health programs, specialised mental health programs, language services, and catch-up immunisation programs, as well as support for education, housing, and other
targeted interventions to ensure newly arrived communities are welcome and included. And we have targeted particularly those to our most recent arrivals from the Syrian refugee crisis. But what we also need to do is to reflect on this as an international challenge, not just a local challenge. And that's where opportunities like your Congress challenge us, not just locally, but to take those challenges globally. Here in Victoria, we value our network of international health partnerships. We know that is essentially, in a globalised world, that we need globalised solutions played out locally. And we look forward to creating new opportunities for collaboration across a wide range of health issues this week. It is only by working and investing together, by making sure that we tackle the cycle of poor health and social disadvantage, that we can make global progress. We know that we can improve health and well-being for all of the peoples of the world, and that in one precondition for how democratic and engaged people capable of delivering a better world on the back of such achievements. Only then will we be able to build a sustainable and peaceful world where citizens can engage on a planet where such rich diversity sees our mutual obligations to one another underpinned by the kind of fraternal links and cooperation that I am sure we will see here built in practice this week. Thank you once again to the World Federation of Public Health Associations for bringing this very important Congress to Melbourne. We wish you all the very best, and we look forward to our shared future being healthy, better, and more sustainable for all humanity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to Honourable Martin Foley. You know, we look at health at an international level, at a national level, at a state level, but actually a great deal of the action happens at the local level. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce a local councillor from the City of Melbourne, Philip Leloux, to address us on the challenges of public health and to welcome us to his city, the City of Melbourne. It's my pleasure to welcome Philip Leloux.
Thank you all, and I think after having Greg and also Martin, it's such a hard act to follow, but I will try to do my best. Thank you, and it's a pleasure to be here with so many leading thinkers from Australia and around the world. Before I go any further, I would like to acknowledge that we are gathered here on the traditional lands of the Kulin Nation, and I pay my respects to the elders past, present, and also emerging. I also like to acknowledge a proud Victorian and also someone who I believe is doing a tremendous job as Minister of Health, the Honourable Greg Hunt. I also like to pay my respect to the respected Martin Foley, the Victorian Minister for Disability and Ageing, Mental Health and Creative Industries, who we have a very good, who have City of Melbourne have a very good relationship with. Auntie Joy Murphy, who welcomed us to country. I always learn something new from her speeches and everything, and it's again, it's a very, very moving welcome to country. From the World Federation of Public Health Association, the passionate Professor Michael Moore and Bettina Burish, and of course the most important people in this room, the Congress delegates who have travelled around the world to be here in Melbourne. On behalf of the City of Melbourne, I'd like to welcome to our great city. I can think of no better place together to share ideas and research outcomes and to discuss ways to improve the health and well-being of the diverse and communities and countries that you work in. You will no doubt have heard from the previous speeches that Melbourne has been dubbed the world's most livable city for 6 years in a row, according to the Economist Intelligence Unit. Before you need to dig any further in a single accolade to understand why this is a city where people want to be, we are truly global, cultural diversity. We are home to people from 200 nations, speaking 260 different languages and dialects, and practicing 135 faiths. I'm pretty much a representation of that from my Chinese background. We value good food, good wine, and excellent coffee. And I can assure you now, Melbourne makes the best coffee. So if you're after one, find one. And I would encourage you all to uncover some of the out-of-the-way and low-key cafes, bars, and restaurants, which makes the city a place to linger in, whether during the day or night. My personal favourite is probably the Eureka Tower, which you can see across all of Melbourne. And I think in terms of this work, you're very lucky to have the comedy festival. And as we all know, laughter is probably the best medicine of all. And we also have the Melbourne Food, Wine and Festival, which is, let's face it, food is to us at the heart of the soul. One of the most interesting characters of Melbourne is that it is both the cultural capital of Australia with a thriving arts scene and a sports mad city. It's only a couple of weeks ago that I had the premier multicultural gala on level 2 here and the Arnold Schwarzenegger event down here in the plenary and Adele's concert just a few blocks away. So this is a city where it's always happening. And another thing that we like to say about a city is that we love parties and festivals and we like to celebrate success. But not only success which comes from the victory or fame, but we also strongly support success in our vibrant knowledge economy. And that is something that we will always wish to celebrate. We are proud of our reputation as a knowledge city and a center of excellencies in education, research, design, and innovation. From fostering a healthy startup culture to being Australia's preferred destination for international students, with 9 major universities located in our municipality. We have a long history as a place of learning and discovery. And again, something like this showcases that. And we know that in order to maximize the well-being dividends of research, collaboration is key. And I hope that every one of you through this week will actually collaborate and partner. That's why we will always welcome global level gatherings like the World Congress on Public Health. So enjoy Melbourne, and I wish you all the best for a successful Congress. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Philip. It's now my great pleasure in welcoming our special performance to conclude this session from the Lionheart Dance Company. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lionheart Dance Company. Just a small insight into the amazing talent we have in young people and what great faith it gives us in the younger generation. Now, before this session concludes, I have two little comments to make. First, congratulations. We're already trending on Twitter. And so for those of you who are busy getting our message out way beyond this Congress, congratulations. Keep it up. And secondly, we have had a media inquiry for people with expertise in floods. if somebody has that expertise, I wonder if you, and Public Health Associated expertise around flood. So if you have that expertise, would you mind coming down the front here and joining us? We will reconvene now at 10:35. We got started a little late because some of you weren't so quick in getting here. So let's see if we can be back in here at 10:35, please. Thank you, everybody.